consumers and constituents are going to pay for this. I mean, if you change the existing contract, one of the ways that we're able to attract the volume of patients is by offering these discounts that have been in place on non-covered services for years. So the price will increase. Thank you.
Very good. Any questions of this? Senator Walsh.
Hi, Mr. Rhodes.
Yes, sir.
Do you know, what's the wholesale price on a frame or a lens? Do you know?
That would be Mr. Durham's category, Senator. We don't sell frames, we don't sell lenses, I don't know.
All right. He's got his mind other places right now.
Oh, do you want an answer?
It
varies depending on, I mean, if you get the high grade, the fancy.
Just a generic frame.
Generic frame that they sell for $700, that they sell for $100 in the store is $7 to $12.
Okay, thank you.
Very good. Any other questions? Seeing none. Well, Senator Munslinger.
Oh, yes, sir.
Sorry, I would prefer it if you'd raise your right hand, Senator Munslinger.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Durham said that his company didn't, and I guess as I listen to your testimony, these are non-covered services also by your company. They don't cover the frames or the lenses, is that correct?
Vision plan, Senator, well, not entirely standard, but I mean, are generally standard coverage or up to a certain limit of coverage. As part of the contract that we signed with providers, one of the provisions in that contract also goes to non-covered. It's a discount on non-covered services, which those subscribers of our insurance plans enjoy.
So these are non-covered services that you... So you don't cover the lenses or the frames?
We cover up to a certain point. At that point, the covered services cease, and you get into a non-covered area.
Which would be your lenses and frames?
Could be. So it could be a variety of reasons, materials, and services that you've hit your policy limit.
Yeah.
And then you get into a non-covered
which
area.
You're covered.
We say non-covered, but it's part of the contract that we offer a discount on services above.
Your coverage would supposedly cover the testing and whatever would go along that, but you're also leaving it open that maybe you might cover a portion of the lens? Yeah,
absolutely. I mean, we will cover up to whatever the coverage policy limit is, Senator. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. That will conclude the hearing. You didn't raise your hand.
I did too.
I didn't see you.
Sorry, Senator. I'll be very brief. Shannon Cooper, representing Blue Cross Blue Shield of Kansas City, Missouri Insurance Coalition. Go on record. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Very good. Any questions? Seeing none. Thank you very much. Anyone else that didn't raise their hand that now wants to testify?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Scott Swing, representing Anthem Blue Cross and Blue Shield.
Very good. Anyone else? Any questions? Seeing none. Last call for opposition testimony. That will conclude the hearing on Senator Wasson's bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
692. Next up, Senator Dixon, 606.
Thanks.
You bet.
Welcome, Senator. Sorry for making you wait.
But all right. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Bob Dixon, District 30, to present Senate Bill 606 for your consideration. Very simply, this is an identical bill to the bill, Senate Bill 479, that your committee approved unanimously last year. It repeals a statute that requires a licensure for our testing and so forth for folks that are selling memberships to prepaid legal service plans. Very briefly, a little bit of history on how this came to my attention. Some constituents contacted me, I believe it was in 2009, after they were contacted by the department and told that they needed to take a test and pay a $100 fee to continue their livelihood. And it was based on a statute that passed, if memory serves correctly, back in 1995. The department waited that long before implementing the statute, and then came up with a test. The questions on the test had absolutely nothing to do with the product or service, the membership that was sold. They did offer to change that once we brought that to their attention. Mr. Chairman, I feel that the best thing to do is to repeal the statute. There's just virtually, that I can come up with, absolutely no reason to have the requirement other than a source of revenue for the state. And the fiscal note speaks to that on the last page. The fiscal impact on small business, the proposal would have a positive fiscal impact on small businesses selling prepaid legal services. They will not be required to be licensed. I just don't see a compelling government interest or public safety issue involved in. So I bring this same bill forward for your consideration. Again, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
We passed this out of here before and we just never made it because of time or?
I filed it late in session last year.
Okay.
So it was, it's quite a bit earlier, and I thank you very much for that. And while I'm speaking to that point, Mr. Chairman, there is a letter en route to your committee requesting consent status on the bill this year. Okay.
Any questions of this witness, the bill sponsor? Seeing none, do you have anyone to testify in support?
There are a few people here who,
very good. Yeah, you came last year, I believe.
I did, sir. Yes, my name is Kirk Gaddis. I worked in legal plans for 23 years now. And as we said, the state at the same time roughly last year, that it just has, there's no risk involved in it. As we said, license is going to protect the public. Our plans, basically, they're just a minimal fee of a monthly basis. There's no lock-in time to them, and we don't see them as any kind. There's no claims, no deductibles, no, it really isn't an insurance product. That's the only category. As Senator Dixon said, it came in 95 and wasn't even enforced until 2009. So we would just like it taken out. Need your help to do that.
Very good. Any questions of this witness? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony.
Thanks, sir.
Anyone else to testify in support? Senator Dixon, 606. Going once. Oh, here we go. We got somebody coming.
Good afternoon, Senator and Chairman. I was here last year also.
Yeah, remember that too.
And
I like your hat.
Oh, thank you.
Didn't have your hat last year, though.
Well, I could buy a new one because it's been on depreciation. But anyway, I've been involved now with our legal plans and program since it's been over 19 years. And just quite frankly, it has nothing to do with insurance. It's almost like a triple A. If you pay a membership fee, you get service. You know, if you don't, you don't have service. But it has nothing to do with insurance, quite frankly. And we've had a lot of people brought on, and just weren't able to have an income simply because of this type of this licensing situation.
Very good. Thank you very much for your testimony. Is there any questions? Seeing none, thank you for coming up again. Anyone else testify in support? Going once. Going twice. Our word. Is that Coach?
Yes.
All right, Coach, come on up. We love to hear from the coach.
23, 8 years
ago, probably
the basketball, I fell off a pickup. Lee and I have not been the same person.
Was it a turnip truck?
Yeah, that's a good one. Don't worry. Chairman, I thank you for the opportunity of coming here today. I was here last year, better shape than I am now, but I don't know, I woke up I was 82 all last year, and I woke up the other morning and I was 83 all in one night. So something's not right here. But anyway, this test and so forth that has absolutely nothing to do, we feel, with our business has hurt us badly, because people are, you know, they're afraid of it, and they should be, because it's not about what we're selling. So we're just trying to thank you and Bob for the opportunity to tell you what our problem is, and it has hurt us badly.
Very good. Any questions with Coach? Thank you very much for your testimony. Make sure all your friends fill out a witness form. Anyone else? Okay, anyone here to testify in opposition? Anyone dare to go against the coach? Seeing none, that will conclude the hearing on Senate Bill 606. Next up is myself on Senate Bill 741. Go as quickly as I can, Senator. I know you're pacing in the background, just chomping to get up here and tell your story. Senator Munslinger. This is a big day for you. Senator Parsons is not here, and you get to jump ahead and take over the committee.
You would like me to do this, Senator?
I would request you do that.
I would be pleased.
Awesome.
Senator, if you could, please proceed.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
741.
It is an honor to be before your esteemed committee. For the record, I am Senator Scott Roop, representing St. Charles County in the 2nd Senatorial District. I am here to bring before you Senate Bill number 741 that deals with authorizing payments at some of our casino organizations here in the state. Simply, here is the issue. You have casinos in our state that have places in multiple other states. And sometimes, especially when we get big tournaments or NCAA things we've been having in St. Louis, or sometimes you get bigger players that just want to travel around and maybe play in a different place. They come in and they have sometimes lines of credit or opportunities to gamble higher amounts at other casinos. When they come to Missouri, those things cannot transfer. So if maybe they're a big player over in Tunica or somewhere else, they come here and they go and they say, well, I have an account, I have some of my money is here. I'm sorry, Missouri does not allow that. So what this bill simply is going to do is say that certain customers will have access to those casino funds that is their money, and there are certain safeguards that we are putting in. So basically they would have to go to the Missouri casino and they would have to apply to be able to come in and access an account, or to say, okay, I want to gamble this amount of money, and I would like within 30 days for you to do an electronic transfer, a bank draft, out of my checking account or whatever account, and you can take the money at that time. So they have to go through a financial background check. So this isn't somebody that's lost their money and is like, oh my God, I got to win it back and stuff. And they have to go through a background check and things of that nature. Really, it's targeting the larger player that is used to not carrying around thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars of cash on them if they like to play higher limits. They just go to the cage and say, I have an account here. I'd like to have access to some funds. This bill does not allow any interest to be accrued between the date that they access the funds and the date that they have it drafted out of their account. It has to be within 30 days, but there's no interest being charged or anything of that nature. You don't put up collateral or anything. It's simply just saying, hey, I'm a person of high net worth. I want to gamble a certain amount at these casinos, and I want you to take that money out of my account on this day of the month, and you can use my brokerage account, you can use my checking account, whatever. Do a background check, make sure I have sustainable money in my various accounts, and I am someone that does not default on payments. And all this has to be done within 30 days. Again, this just helps make Missouri businesses that operate in the gaming industry being more competitive, especially when we just passed a tax credit to try to get some of these huge sports games and tournaments to come into town. And with that come people that like to spend a lot of money and gamble, and we want them to be able to help fund education in our state at the whatever amount that they want to do that. That's what the bill does. Gladly answer any questions. If not, I have a witness.
Really? Senator, I believe this is a bill I think we've heard at least one year before. Is that correct?
Yes, I believe. It went to a different committee last year, but this is something that was brought up last year, late in session.
I know I'd seen it before, maybe more than once, I'm not for sure. But these individuals are actually, like you said, background check. Who does that?
The casino would have to do the background check and say, okay, this person is financially available to do this.
Okay, other questions? Seeing none, would you please call?
Do you know Troy Stremming with Pinnacle, who's here, testify?
I'd like to remind you to fill out a witness.
Got one right here.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, committee members. My name is Troy Stremming. I'm Executive Vice President of Government Relations and Public Affairs for Pinnacle Entertainment. For those of you who are not familiar with Pinnacle Entertainment, we now have four casinos currently that we own and operate in the state of Missouri. We have about 5,000 employees. We have about $2 billion of capital investment in the market. My plan was to talk to you a little bit about why this is important to our industry, walk through how a transaction would actually occur, and then just talk briefly about some of the safeguards that are in the bill. Senator Roop has done a great job of actually walking through that process. But I think one thing that is important to remember is that casino customers look for convenience when they're visiting casinos. And unfortunately, some customers, both from Missouri as well as out-of-state residents, choose to gamble in casinos that are outside the state of Missouri right now based on that convenience, as the senator spoke to when it comes to credit. Unlike many states, Missouri does not allow customers to authorize a predetermined amount of money to be withdrawn from their banking account in exchange for access to casino funds, and that means that those individuals and the state, those individuals gamble elsewhere. The state of Missouri not only loses casino tax revenue, but also tourism in the state. SB 741 would update that law to be like most other jurisdictions. There are several. Some that come to mind, Illinois, Indiana, Louisiana, Nevada, New Jersey, there are several. So from a competitive standpoint, it does make a difference. And in short, the legislation will just allow those customers to access those funds while ensuring proper safeguards. I'd be more than happy to talk about the specifics of how a transaction would occur, but I think just giving you an example might be helpful. Right now we have 14 casinos scattered throughout the United States. In many cases, whether it's sporting events or what have you, some of those customers that we know that are very good customers travel across the country. A good example would be, we have a huge database in Houston because of our Lake Charles, Louisiana operation. When the Houston Texans come to Kansas City to play the Kansas City Chiefs, there might be a desire for that individual to travel to that market, but we have absolutely no ability to get them into a casino to gamble in Missouri because let's say this individual has resources that they could gamble $30,000. They're not going to get on a plane with $30,000 with them. And as you know, ATM machines or ATM cards don't allow, in a lot of cases, for significant withdrawals. No one wants to put a cash advance like that on a credit card, and the fact of the matter is you don't have credit. So that's business that does not come to the state of Missouri. So it is a convenience. I think from a tourism standpoint, it's something that we're missing. And from a consumer protection standpoint, the bill prohibits interest to accrue between the time the customer accesses the casino funds and the period of time that they're repaid, which cannot exceed 30 days. It also prohibits collateral to be pledged on the amount of funds that have been issued. And I'd be more than happy to answer any questions you might have about the bill.
Are there any questions from the committee? Doesn't appear to be. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Do you have other witnesses?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Mike Winter, representing the Missouri Gaming Association, which is the trade group for all 13 casinos operating in Missouri. I don't want to rehash what Senator Roop and Mr. Stringham have said, so let me just indicate our support for Senate Bill 741. The language changes are primarily on page 2 and page 8, so if there are members of the committee who have questions, I can respond to those at another time.
One quick one, and I should ask Mr. Stringham when he was up there, maybe. So really, this would probably be the only really good way for those individuals to gain access and play as they would like to. I mean, other than carrying a suitcase full of money, we could probably get questioned if you went to Mario for that much money anyway.
Yeah, I think this is the most convenient way for an individual who could establish a line of credit, and then we could extend that line of credit to them at their discretion and our approval.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Do not. Thank you. All right. Others who wish to testify in favor?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is John Barger. I'm here as a registered lobbyist on behalf of the St. Louis County Economic Council and the St. Louis Convention and Visitors Commission. We're in total support of this bill again this year. We are in the business of trying to attract all types of visitors to our region and our state. And I think we all know that nobody knows how to attract visitors to their locations better than the people in Mr. Strumming's industry. We'd like to see those people come to our region and to our state. We're in total support.
Any questions? Thank you. Others?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Jay Adkins, General Counsel for the Missouri Chamber of Commerce and Industry. We supported this bill last year, and we'd like to work and support again this year.
Any questions for Mr. Adkins?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any others who wish to testify in favor of this bill? Seeing none, are there any that would wish to testify in opposition to Senate Bill 741. Seeing none, Senator Root, thank you for presenting Senate Bill 741. You're doing such a great job.
Under your guidance, sir.
Very good. Thank you, committee, for rushing through all those bills so that Senator Root can where is she at? She's here. We have cleared the deck for you, Senator. Next up, Senate Bill 531.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. For the record, I am Senator Jamila Nasheed, representing the 5th Senatorial District, City of St. Louis. Today I present to you Senate Committee Substitute for Senate Bill 531 for your consideration and support. Senate Committee Substitute for Senate Bill 531 creates the Minimum Wage Act in the state of Missouri upon voter approval. Currently, an individual who works a full-time job at a minimum wage level and who supporting a family of three will fall below the federal poverty line, Mr. Chairman. To me, that is appalling. The citizens of Missouri deserve better. Missourians deserve better wages. Workers in Missouri, despite putting in regular hours, are struggling each and every day to provide basic necessities for themselves and their families. That is unacceptable. Currently, the minimum wage in the state of Missouri is $7.35. That is not a livable wage, Mr. Chairman. Senate Committee Substitute for Senate Bill 531 raises the minimum wage from $7.35 to $10 an hour. The minimum wage tip wage also increases from 50% to 60% of the minimum wage. This bill also specifies that the cost of living adjustment applies each year, regardless of whether the statutory minimum or federal minimum is used. Section 290.527 increases the penalties for paying lower than minimum wage from the full amount of the wage rate to twice that amount as compensation for loss, and extends the statute of limitation for bringing claims from 2 to 3 years. That's the gist of the bill. Mr. Chairman, this year alone, 20 states have already proposed increasing the minimum wage. The question is, why shouldn't we? With big paychecks, workers in Missouri can promote growth and consumer spending, and hopefully can provide for them for their families. And hopefully they also can set an example for Congress to follow. Studies have shown that states with minimum wage increases, such as New Jersey and Illinois, haven't experienced any increase in unemployment, but have actually seen growth in employment according to the National Employment Law Project. Mr. Chairman, increasing the minimum wage is not a handout. These are workers. They have jobs, and now they need dignity. With that, Mr. Chairman, I am open to any questions. Thank you.
Very good. So, the President of the State of the Union, he mentioned something about raising the minimum wage to around $10.
$10.10. Correct.
Now, you pre-filed this right back in December.
Sure.
Did you have an advanced copy of his State of the Union speech?
No, actually, we're just on the same page.
Or is he following your lead?
I think he's following my lead.
All right. Any questions of the bill sponsor? Okay, before you get into your witness list, can I get a show of hands of how many people would like to testify in support of this bill? Okay, how many would like to testify in opposition? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. All right.
Chairman, you want to borrow my pen?
Really, the calculator. How about this? Do you have a list?
Have a list.
Okay.
I know. Do you? I want to come up and then the rest of them.
Okay. How many are on your list?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 9.
Okay. And so then, why don't we go? I'll go about three-ish minutes for the people that she calls up, and I'll see how much time I have. I'll probably pause, take some opposition testimony so that they have adequate time, and then we'll go back to those in support before that we have to be out of here. The only thing I would recommend is do not read your testimony. Just talk to us, tell us your story. Because if you have something written, we can read that. We'd just rather hear your own story. Senator, call your first witness.
Okay, we have Matt Neal, a Western University economist.
Good afternoon. My name is Alan McNeil. I'm a professor of economics at Webster University in St. Louis. I have some written comments turned in as well, and I'll try to be brief. I do have a lot of numbers. I'm an economist, so I apologize for that. I want to talk first about the figure of $10, and a lot of people might think that that's quite a significant raise. Actually, we need to put that in context, that over the past 45 years, the value of the minimum wage has been declining in value. It has not kept up with the cost of living. If it had kept up with the rate of inflation, the minimum wage today would be $10.71. It has not kept up with the growth of productivity as it had in previous decades. If the minimum wage had kept up with worker productivity, our lowest paid workers would be earning $18.30 an hour. So actually $10 is quite moderate. It doesn't even get us up to what the minimum wage was in 1968. Also, as the Senator mentioned, the minimum wage today is not sufficient to support a family at a decent standard of living. raising the minimum wage to $10 would lift a family of minimum wage family of three above the poverty line. There are many economic benefits of increasing the minimum wage. One of them is that low-wage workers are likely to spend all of their extra income on their needs, and that will boost the overall level of demand in the economy. The Federal Reserve